Hi everyone, it's Genevieve from Kangaroo Time. Thank you so much for watching the recording of our webinar right now. At Kangaroo Time, we create software for childcare centers. We're an all-in-one solution that helps centers grow their business, connect with their families, and effectively manage their staff members. Our software will help you automate your entire business, including payments, billing, check-in and check-out for children, keeping track of staff hours. We also do classroom automation, and this gives your teacher prompts while they're in the classroom to update parents on feedings, diaper changes, and developmental milestones. And it really hardwires the parents into the early education experience, and they get a beautiful feed of content right on their smartphones. So if you're looking for billing and a payment solution, a parent app, or staff scheduling, contact Kangaroo Time today. Thanks so much and enjoy the webinar.
Hello. Hey, guys. Welcome to the Kangaroo Time webinar series starring Prerna Richards and Mayor Harman. Ladies, thank you so much for being here with us. We are so proud to have you. Oh, where'd Genevieve go? She just drops off. I'm here in Buffalo, New York. Mayor, you're in Florida, right?
Yes. Tampa Bay area.
And I'm sure it's a little humid there. And Prerna, you're in hot North Texas.
Yep, Plano, Texas.
Where the people are the gold of the earth, but it is so hot this time of year. It is so hot.
It's true. It's muggy.
How hot is it? Oh,
it feels like 107. It feels like 107 right now. It's super muggy.
Yes.
Gosh. Okay. Well, it's glorious here in Buffalo, New York. The summers are just fantastic. Come and see us. You will love it. There's that waterfall attraction everybody talks about. But all right, let's get started. Thanks, guys, for joining us. We're really excited about this topic. This one's going to be about inclusion and diversity. And this is something that as we look at our centers and look at our businesses, there's no real formalized playbook out there. So, and also we feel like, and I think Prerna and Mayor, you will agree, that this is kind of the key to building a healthy culture and business. And it's at the core, the DNA, if we all build our businesses with cultures of kindness, there's a foundational element here. But before we jump into the topic, everybody, we want to thank you for joining us. I'm Scott Wayman. I'm the founder and CEO at Kangaroo Time. I founded Kangaroo Time in 2015 because I felt like the education industry was severely lacking great tech. And as a parent, I saw how challenging the business was. And that I knew that the gold of the earth are our customers, those of you that have dedicated your lives to building bodies, minds, and souls. You needed help, and you needed a help from great software companies. Hello, Key West. I was just there.
Florida.
I was just at Vernon Mason's conference. It was incredible. For those of you that didn't get to go, there were only 50 people there. Look for Vernon's conference next year in Key West. Vernon is kind of like, I think he's the mascot of Key West. He's gone every year multiple times. It was so fun. And the first night, I went out, I had dinner, and I got back at 11. I called my wife and said, I'm being really good. And then I woke up the next day and saw a few of our customers, and they were like, where were you? We were out till 3. And I said, "That I don't do that." And then the next two nights, that was me. I was out with everybody, partying until 3, not doing anything too terribly debaucherous. but that's a fun conference. Okay, real quick, I got to get through like another minute of housekeeping. Guys, if you're interested in seeing our software in action, we offer demos on Tuesdays and Thursdays. They're group demos. They're 30 minutes. They're no pressure. So for those of you that don't want to be like in the tractor beam of a salesperson, you just jump on. It's anonymous. Go to kangarootime.com and then /schedule a demo. Just go to our website. You'll see the little link there. Also, for those of you that have not joined KT Childcare Connect on Facebook, please go there. There's an embarrassment of wealth of information from those of you that have joined. We went over 1,000 people in that group. It's one of the more active child care center support groups, our early educator support groups. We do some digital storytelling on there, which was really interesting during COVID to see how the Nike-shaped curve was going. You know, we took the big dip in March, April, May last year, and then we've just kind of slowly gone up. And there's also resources there. Also, please go hit our blog. This content will end up there. Our YouTube channel, go to YouTube and search Kangaroo Time and subscribe and pound the like button when you watch a video. Okay, that said, we're really excited to bring you today's webinar. Prerna and Mare will be discussing diversity and inclusion along with simple, practical tips to create environments where everyone is welcome and included. Prerna is a coach, consultant, trainer. Many of you on this call have been part of her content before. She has been in the early childhood education field for the last 35 years. So Prerna, you started when you were 2 years old. That's really impressive. And then Maryann Mare Harman, we call her Mare, is a music educator and the founder of International Music with Mare program. Also, she's the lead singer of a rock and roll band. So when I was going to call you a rock star anyway, but you really are. And she has her first live gig on Saturday. Doesn't it just feel like we're getting back? It's I'm so happy. So she has a weekly music program in which parents come with their children to learn how to use music to better prepare for school and life in general. Thank you for being here. I'm going to turn it over to you two. I will be here to interject. If you have any questions, just to test me to see if I'm listening, go for it. Guys, I'm glad to present Mare and Prerna. You will get your certificates for participating in this tomorrow. If you have questions, please leave them in the Q&A button here on Zoom, and we'll get to those. Your microphones and cameras are turned off, and you will get a recording of this tomorrow. Mare, Prerna, happy to have you here.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Let's get going. Here we go. So today, thank you so much for joining. And thank you so much, Scott and Jen, for Kangaroo Time, for this platform. And here's what our time together will cover. We'll talk about the definition of diversity, inclusion, equality, and equity. What is the difference? I think it's important to have the definition out front so we're all on the same page. And we'll talk about the role of emotional intelligence in all of this. Does it matter? Does it not matter? What does that look like? And then, of course, we will share some good music, easy activities to have in your classrooms that you can bring culture in your classrooms. Anything else you want to add, Mare?
You did it perfectly.
All right, here we go. So I'm going to stop my share and...
Okay, so you saw a screen there that showed people dancing. That's actually like down in the Cayman Islands. Unfortunately, like what I do, I get to travel all these different wonderful places. It's just part of the job. But anyway, so I want to demonstrate to you what it feels like to be in a classroom or a work environment, and you have no idea what...
Shalom lekulam, harimu et hayadayim. Shalom lekulam, harimu et hayadayim. Shalom lekulam, harimu et hayadayim. Hayek el
ay. There you go.
Shalom lekulam, harimu et hayadayim. Histovevu. Shalom lekulam, harimu et hayadayim. Histovevu. Shalom lekulam, harimu et hayadayim. Histovevu.
So So that's all I'm going to play for now. And I know that Scott's over there jamming out. Now he wants to know how the song ends. But you can do that because I'm giving away a few song downloads. So afterwards, if there's a song here you heard, you're going to have the ability to go get it without it costing you a thing. But besides that, it's all on Spotify. And I've been thrilled to know that Alexa now officially knows who I am. So she will play it for you as well. But anyway, so in that song, Shalom Lekulam, that's Hebrew. And I'm sure not everyone here speaks Hebrew. And so teacher gets up in the front of the room and she's telling you what to do, or you get into a new work environment and the person in charge of the meeting is talking a little bit differently than you're used to and you're not quite understanding. So that's why music is a good way to break the ice, but also to help. Because if you noticed, when I was saying histovevu, no one knew what that meant. But then when I went like this, went, oh, must mean lift your arms. But when we got to the part that said hayek eli, you didn't know what that meant, but I went like this. And I know that Scott and Prerna smiled. That's because the song said, smile a smile for me. So this song is really helpful. A friend of mine that teaches down in Palm Beach County, Florida, there was a very large influx of Guatemalan children a few years back. And she did the song in English, which is, hey, hey, everybody, lift your arms. Well, by the end of the song, it's turn around, stamp your foot, get down, stand up, make a silly sound. So for all of them, you can see emotion. Your arms, turn around, stamp your foot. But when it gets, and all the Guatemalan children were smiling because they were successful. They were doing everything along with their classmates and they felt wonderful. And that's a way that music really, really helps. And I wanted to begin this workshop with that point that we can't always take for granted that you're talking to somebody and they understand you. You know, and I will tell you a quick story. I come from an Italian-Irish background. I married into a family from Western Pennsylvania, Hanover. Went out there and there was, for the first time after visiting there 10 years, a real Italian restaurant. I was so excited, La Cucina. So I took the whole family to dinner and they couldn't read the menu. Now, I was sitting there going, it's not like it's in another language, everybody. And they all looked at me and went, it's in Italian. I grew up in New Jersey, and you know, if you grew up in Buffalo, you know there are a lot of Italian restaurants, and everybody gets used to the Italian words on a menu. You don't think of it, but it is another language. And so in the environment in Western Pennsylvania, they had no idea what was on that menu, and I learned that I was being a little bit culturally insensitive. You know, I don't do that anymore because I've taken this course with Prerna. Anyway, I'm going to leave it at that for now and I'll let Prerna get back to our slideshow.
Okay, can you give me control of sharing the screen? Because I think yours.
Sure, because I will stop my share and yep. We'll go back to sharing.
Yep, there you go. That's how we do it. Okay, so I think that was really nice to hear music and I think that's really good to know that, you know, music is a language that everybody can speak. Okay, a little bit, you know, if we're gonna come together, we're gonna breathe and we're gonna relax our brain. So before we go any further, let's just take a minute to get some fresh oxygen in so our brains are engaged, ready to learn. Here we go. Let's reach for the sky breathing. So this time, as we take a deep breath, fill up your lungs, reach for the sky. Here we go. And since we have to do 3 deep breaths, let's do the heart one next. Here we go. Fill up our heart with love for everybody. Spreading kindness and love. And the second one, we can just cross our, as we give ourselves a hug, let's take a deep breath. All right. So Mayor introduced herself by saying she has Italian background and heritage, and I think it's really important to know who's talking to you about diversity. So a little bit about me. I grew up in India, married a Scotsman, went to Scotland, and so we have two daughters. So they were half Scottish and half Indian. Now I have grandkids. So my older daughter married an American. So my granddaughter is mixed, also got American in there. My younger daughter lives in Switzerland, married a Swiss lawyer, so, and they have children. So now you see how it's becoming less the next generation. And the reason I point that out is really, if you think about it, the world is one. There are no physical lines, there are no physical barriers. That's man-made, that's man-created. So the globe, the map, it's all man-made. And we create differences based on which part of the world we come from, based on where, you know, geographically you're located, or just by our skin tone or our hair color or our eye color, which we have no control over. So I wanted to share that truly I belong to the United Nations. It's truly the United Nations in my house, and I appreciate that. And I think this is why I'm also very passionate about this topic. And I want to talk about it to everybody, because I have empathy for people who haven't left their zip code, who have been raised in that zip code that traditionally their parents, grandparents all lived there. When you see the world, you know, your perspectives change. So I wanted to share a story about this old house. And since I can do plagiarism, I have to give credit where credit is due. I'm part of a book club right now. This is the book I'm reading. It's called The Cast. Mayor alluded to a course that we did. Her and I finished a 7-week certification course together from the University of South Florida on diversity, equity, and inclusion. And so I was doing that course while I was part of a book club doing this deep dive. And I appreciated that so much, because you could hear different perspectives, different lens. So anyway, Isabel Wilkinson, who is the author of this book, she framed it very beautifully, which I really like how she framed this. So I don't know where each one of who's listening is living, but the house that I live in was built in 1970. So when we moved to Texas in 1990s, we bought this house. When we signed that deed, the house became ours. Once it became ours, we inherited everything that the house came with. So if the roof was not working, or the foundation wasn't working, or something needed repair, that was our responsibility. We no longer could say the previous owners, or I didn't cause that, right? It became ours. And I liked how Isabel framed it in this book. She calls America an old house. It is a house for all of us. It is our house. We live here. So whether we came later, whether we came sooner, whether we were born here, it doesn't matter. It's our house, and it's our responsibility to take care of the house. So each one of us plays a part in bringing all of us together. This is ours. It's not somebody else's. And I think when we look at America with that lens, it helps us to recognize that we each play a part in maintaining. And if something is not working, let's fix it. Otherwise, it can continue. So,
Prerna, if I may interrupt, we've said this before, that we get used to doing these workshops in America, but what you just said applies all over the world.
Mm-hmm. It's global.
A global thing.
Yeah. And I think we're more similar than we're different.
Yes.
That is my honest belief, that, you know, as humans, we have more things in common than we have not in common. And if we come from that lens, it can become a healthier, kinder, compassionate place instead of, I also heard this phrase that people sometimes have this fear that it's like a pie. If you get a slice, then I don't get a slice. I don't agree with that, because there's enough space for everybody's talents, everybody's skills, and you can be you, and that's enough. You're enough, and I can be me, and I don't have to be like you. So If any questions come up, if anything comes up, just let us know. We'll keep an eye on it. But Scott's keeping an eye on it, right, Scott? Or anything else? Okay, keep going. All right. Mayor, is this? Oh, go ahead.
Yeah, this is mine. And just keep the share up. If I'm going to switch to a song, I will let you know. And thank you for doing that for me. I appreciate it. So there are many factors to consider when we think about diversity, inclusion, and equity. And most people, the first thing they always think of is race, because skin color is just so prominent. You know, it's like right there in your face. You can look at somebody right away and know what color their skin is. And so a lot of people seem to think that that's the biggest basis for prejudices or racism. But there are a lot of other factors. Age. Some people get really, they'll hear somebody is 70 and they're like, oh, so you're really slowing down now, you know. Gender, you know, a lot of times that happens with, you know, women, where a man wants to step in and with that new phrase, mansplain everything, like as if a woman didn't understand. But that goes two ways too, because a woman should just not take for granted that just because somebody's male, they know how to change the oil in your car. They might not. That might not be something that was of interest to them. Abilities. You can't just look at somebody and know what those abilities are. Some people, they might have something that is changes their lifestyle, but you can't see it. Like diseases like lupus or lung problems. Most of the time you can see a person and have no idea that that's why they're walking slowly. And we seem to lose, you know, this is why I don't ask you to come any place, because you're always so slow. And that in itself is not being accepting and inclusive of people. Religion. When, you know, a few years back, I had picked up a book, The Religions of the World, and it was an old signet book that I found in a yard sale. And it was like only that thick, cost me 10 cents. Best book on religion I ever read. And basically every religion is the same. They just call their God by a different name. Every religion says, love yourself so you can love others. Treat other people the way you would like to be treated, and have respect for a higher authority, no matter what religion. Language, and I have a slide coming up about language. We hear different accents, and we might just automatically think something about somebody. I know in the United States, the Southern accent sometimes gets a bad rap. And it's very upsetting, because there, it doesn't matter what you sound like, because I'm from New Jersey and I can walk the dog, but that doesn't mean that I'm not as capable as someone that could speak the proper English.
Mayor, if I could just add with the language, the accent Please. Really does sometimes make people think that you're less intelligent mm-hmm. because you sound different mm-hmm. and from immigrants and from other. So people become self-conscious and they don't.
Yes. And
hey, Maryann, I think I'd like to add too, you know, when it comes to when you were playing that song and I thought about what happens to me cognitively when there's music. When I was with my last company, many of our employees were from Egypt, or they were Arab, and most were Muslim. And we had some that were Muslim, some that were Christian, Coptics. And traditionally, those are some very tense religious worldviews, right? Like they hate each other. They've been at war for many, many centuries. And I think something we decided to do, not tactically, not to bring people together, but we started when we would travel, because we traveled so much, we would book concerts and music and attend and support each other. And I've been to some crazy, there's this guy named Simon Sharif. He's a famous musician out of Egypt, and he plays this weird kind of recorder thing called the Knob, and it's very beautiful. And I've been in a room with thousands of people listening to him with his biggest fans, and I've never heard of him. And then I've taken a couple of friends to Hall & Oates that were like, we've never really listened to music, but Daryl Hall is a genius. But the binding element there was sharing each of our favorites, what spoke to our souls, and being able to enjoy that together and educate, like driving to the concert and hearing about this guy and the instrument he was about to play and how he carved it out of, you know, a piece of bamboo when he was in poverty in Egypt and Cairo. It just brings people together. It breaks down barriers. And the socioeconomic status, religion, language, all those things can be broken down by caring for each other's kind of cultural ties and backgrounds.
Yes, and I do a entire workshop on that, so you'll have to have me back for another webinar, Scott, just on that topic.
I would love it.
It's called, I'm in the middle of writing a book right now called Building Brains with Music. Music is so wonderful to help the brain healthy, you know, physically, mentally, emotionally, all way around. But when it comes to DEI, it's almost impossible to be angry with someone when you're dancing together. Yep. Or when you're in a room where there's music and food. Put music and food in a room and anyone can get along, you know? And so that's the final point there, you know, like socioeconomic status. Also, being careful of noticing just because somebody comes into work or school and they don't have the latest fashions on, you know, like that the Four Seasons back in the 1960s, not that I remember those days, but they had the Ragdoll song. People actually talked about labeling people from the wrong side of the tracks. And that kind of stuff has to be stopped. If you can change the screen, please, yeah. Prerna, and then you look like you wanted to say something.
No, I was just saying you're so spot on. Music does break barriers. Yep. Okay.
And that's what this next slide is about. We all sing in different keys. I did a song called Multicultural Feast, and the studio I was working in, they're like, but Mayor, these instruments don't play together. Well, I mean, I don't know if you could see behind me, I have Cuban conga drums and African drum, and there's a Celtic Bodhran drum back behind me too. And the instruments, like the people, can blend together if we play them together. So at the end of this song, I took the algaida from Iran and put it with the koto from Japan and put them all together. So we all sing in different keys, but we can blend. And disability doesn't hinder your ability to be considered equal. Different key can be English is your second or third language. Your ability, whether you're physically or mentally capable, and your intelligence level. And Prerna is gonna talk about not just your IQ, but your EQ, emotional intelligence, ability to read people's feelings, your environment, where you live, and your economic standing. You know, you can come down to Florida and it's a whole different feel where people wear flip-flops in February, you know, than if you're up in Alaska and you and want to stay away from saying things like, well, this is odd, and replace that with, it was different. Because when you use those words like that, you're showing a predisposition to think it's odd instead of different. Doesn't different sound so much nicer?
Yep. So, I think odd makes it sound like it's less than, and different makes it sound like I'm curious and interested.
Right. Yep. So it's like if somebody feeds you food you never ate before, yep, you know, and you just don't like it, you're not going to go, oh, this is disgusting. You say, oh, this is interesting. I've never tasted this flavor before.
All right.
And I'm not sure if I have another slide. No, this is, okay. Yeah.
So now it's time to interact. So whoever's listening, here's where you jump in. What do you think, from your perspective, diversity means? I'm not looking for a definition, just from your perspective. Just put D and write something. What do you think of when you think of diversity? What do you think of when you think of inclusion? I'll give you a few minutes, because we got to engage somehow. Otherwise, I wish we weren't together in the room. We could see each other. All right, so put it in the chat. What does D mean to you? What does I mean to you? And there's no right or wrong answers. It's, and maybe you need to do it to everyone. So write to, is that an option, Jen? Can they write to everyone, or is it just to the panelists? I see just to the panelists. I'm not sure.
Yeah, everybody can talk in the chat. So you can use the chat to share.
Yeah, all panelists and all attendees. So write it in there. I'm looking for, yeah, diversity. What does it mean to you? So not just the word, but D, and just tell us what you think it means. Yeah, united, equal. Give a few more, and also for maybe for inclusion, what do you guys think? You thought you were sitting and just relaxing and just listening, right? Now I'm putting you to work.
I like that mixture of cultures and family.
Being different, yes. What else?
Then that, maybe you'll talk on that.
Mm-hmm. Working with people who look and think differently. Okay, great. So this is awesome. Keep it coming. I'm going to share the definition that the dictionary gives us for diversity. I'm going to take a minute to just read it. It means understanding that each individual is unique and recognizing our individual differences. These can be along the dimensions of race, ethnicity, gender, sexual orientation, socioeconomic status, age, physical abilities, learning differences, religious beliefs, political beliefs, or other ideologies. What word stands out to you as you read this definition? So keep it coming, but Scott, do you want to take a stab? What word stands out to you from this definition?
Okay, so you want to hear my definition? I wrote, I think of diversity as a balanced diet that allows you to live forever, and every bite tastes so amazing.
Love it. I love it. I love it. You know, I can feel the passion in there.
Yeah, and now I'm hungry.
I know, speaking of.
Yeah, but
I think it's important to point out that when we say someone is different, we have to also realize that their viewpoint of us is the same. They think we're different. So when you say different, you have to realize that we're all different.
Yeah, but what word stands out to either you, Mayor, or Scott from this definition? And whoever's listening can put it in the chat. What speaks to you as you look at this definition from the dictionary?
I think understanding, right?
I was like just going to say that.
I think at the core of appreciating diversity, that intellectual curiosity, that, you know, what I think is so beautiful about really prolific, diverse ecosystems is people are curious, and they're curious in that positive, optimistic way of, the wanderlust. I want to go, Prerna, I want to go and visit your family because they're in beautiful places. And those experiences have always been really positive and full of learning and seeing how other people have lived for thousands and thousands of years and seeing community and family and beauty.
Yep.
So understanding and that intellectual curiosity is so... Yep. Seems like utopia to me.
I would also add unique and recognizing. I think once we recognize and understand that each one of us is unique, I think then that helps us to be like, okay, we're enough, because we're, you know, what about inclusion? This is the definition of inclusion, the act of including someone or something as part of a group, list, or etc., or a person or thing that is included. It's a feeling of being accepted. And a deliberate act of acceptance. What word stands out from this definition? Put it in the chat if you're listening, or Scott or Mayor, what stands out to you? What one word stands out?
Acceptance. Mm-hmm. I love that word.
Prerna and Mare, the one that stands out for me is deliberate. Mm-hmm. Because inclusion, I think exclusivity or exclusion and inclusion have a singular kind of commonality, and that is it's very deliberate. You make a decision. Mm-hmm. Your culture, your business, your families, you can make those decisions, and they're very deliberate to be accepting or exclusive. So it's got to be a mindset, right? That deliberate part.
So what stands out to me is that it's a feeling. It's an emotion. You have to feel it. So the organization could say, we have inclusive policies. You could have checked all the boxes, but if the person on the team doesn't feel included, you missed the boat, because it's an emotion that has to be experienced. So I agree. The acceptance deliberate feeling is at the core of inclusion. And so here we go for another. Oh, I love this quote. So this is, by the way, a poet from India, Rabindranath Tagore. I don't know how many of you guys know him, but he was famous for his work in inclusion and diversity. And so he wrote many songs, he wrote many books, and this is what he wrote. The problem is not how to wipe out all our differences, but how to unite with all differences intact. And I think this is powerful, because nobody is saying that one is more important than the other, or one is less, or nobody needs to be insecure. Nobody needs to have a fearful approach to this, but we want to recognize that you are enough, and you bring value to the team, to the plate, to the puzzle. And we want to appreciate you while recognizing that we're all different.
Yes.
So this is now for in the chat, please put, what do you think equality means and what do you think equity means? Just so we can get some engagement going. I know they're both E's, so you could put one and number two. So one for equality, what do you think that means? And number two, what do you think equity means? I'll give you a few minutes to share your thoughts. Thank you, by the way, for those who are engaging with us. We appreciate you. Anybody else want to share, what do you think equality and equity means to you? All right, because I know it's a very short time, I'm going to proceed. So this is the definition of equality. Equality means having equal opportunities, universal access. And I think that's at the heart of it, right? Equality is just having the opportunity, having access, that everybody has it. So that's really the key. Then this is equity, means making the playing field level, giving what each person needs to succeed, keeping their individual circumstances in mind. So if I was to give an example, you're in a school and you're having parent-teacher conferences. That's equality. If everybody has a chance to sign up, that's equality. But for the parent who needs translation, the parent who doesn't understand the written language in a different language, you allow for a longer time because you're going to have translation. That's equity. You met the person where they're at and you flexed it so that they could be successful just like everybody else. This is fascinating to me. At what age children start recognizing differences? This is absolutely interesting. So if you look at 2.5, by 30 months, most children use race to choose their playmates. Like, does that not just blow your mind? A toddler at 2.5 can choose playmates based on the color of their skin.
And I have something interesting that I'm going to be adding to that.
Yeah. So, and you know, we can see all of this, that a gradual progression happens. But guess what? This is really exciting, because I always want to be in the positive space. This is what catches my attention with this research. Between 5 and 7 years, that means kindergarten and second grade, if you start having explicit conversations with young children, in just 1 week, they can dramatically change who their friends are. Think about it. If you're having intentional conversations with kindergartners to second grade, we could change their path moving forward. They don't have to continue choosing based on discrimination on the outside. We could change it for them. I think that's powerful, the role we play as educators. All right, go for it, Mayor.
So in a study, what they found was that accent actually trumps the color of skin. A white American baby would rather accept food from a Black English-speaking adult than from a white Parisian. And a five-year-old would rather befriend a child of another race who sounds like their local place where they live than of someone of the same race that has a foreign accent. So sound is very, very important to making us feel comfortable. And so it is important that in the early years, we hear sounds from all different cultures, which is why I produced that CD, Everybody Speaks Music, so that they can hear the songs like the Hokey Pokey in Farsi, instead of just hearing it in English. And without having to talk about it to the child, you are actually putting in the brain an acceptance. Mm-hmm. So the one part of the building brains with music, the brain itself is designed to go into fight or flight if it sees or hears something that is different than what they are used to. So if a child sees someone with darker skin and they've never seen someone with darker skin before, their brain's gonna go, uh-oh, that's mm-hmm. different. Do you have to protect yourself or should you run away? So, the earlier we let children grow up with dolls and books and puppets and sounds of all the different cultures and seeing people of all different skin colors and shades, the earlier their brain begins to accept that. I think you could change the slide if you would, Prerna. We do it not because we say to the children, like, I like to use puppets with children. Now, these two puppets happen to be teaching feelings, working on the emotional intelligence, right? When I was growing up, somebody would have probably said, well, look at this Negro child. Why? Why couldn't you just say, look at this child. Look at the facial expressions. No, look at this child. What's different about this facial expression? The point is, you don't need to point out the differences. Just let them be there. And then you do that with puppets, you do that with books. So I love the book, the I Am the Music Man, which I have in my hand here. And one of the reasons I love it so much is because it's about music, first of all, but the diversity of the children and people. It's not just children. You'll notice that there is a boy who has dark tone skin. He's in a wheelchair. He's playing a trombone. There's an elderly woman with light tone skin playing a bass drum. There's an elderly man conducting. There's a young girl and playing the saxophone, and a little boy who I think, if I look here more, who is on a skateboard with a violin. And I would say, that I'm not too happy with, because no, do not condone playing violin on a skateboard.
Yeah.
But all this diversity within the book allows the children to see that everybody makes music.
Mm-hmm.
And when I do this book with the children, I don't talk to them about it. I don't say to them, see the boy with the dark tone skin? I say, see the boy playing the trombone. That's the instrument that slides. Where is he sitting? Why is he sitting in that type of chair? Open conversation, so it becomes part of who they are, and do it through using books, music, puppets, children's value system, and their morality is all in place by the end of their seventh year of life.
That's fascinating.
So whatever we put in up until then is going to be who they are. It will and just their mindset that Prerna is going to talk about.
So it's at, mindset is at the heart of the conversation, right? So I wanted to show a visual because I just love this. So
me too. I love this.
Yeah. Who remembers back in the 90s, we used to have a cell phone right in the middle that looked like a brick. Put it in the chat if you remember that, because I remember we were in Hawaii. We got, that was our first cell phone for the family. I don't think we ever used it because we put it in the glove compartment of our car for emergency, but I don't know. I remember. Yeah. So then we fast forward that, right? So we had the brick and then we fast forward to 2000 and Nokia came. We all remember the Nokia tune in our sleep, right? We heard it so much. And then fast forward to today, 2021. We all have the world in our palms. I don't know about you, but you could not pay me any amount of money to go back to the brick cell phone. Like, seriously, I'm never going back to that. I'm never going to ever use it. Not going to happen. I've seen something better and I've seen a better way and my mindset has changed. The other one that I really love is perspective taking, right? So somebody can see a six and be absolutely stuck on the point that this is a six. And then somebody could see a nine and be stuck on the point that this is nine. But you're both right.
Yes.
And so helping to see somebody else's perspective, helping to understand somebody else's perspective is emotional intelligence in action. So emotional intelligence has two parts. This is absolutely spot on with diversity. So the first part of emotional intelligence is self-awareness. How aware am I of my biases? How aware am I of my strengths and weaknesses? The thing that is really fascinating, that if we have a human brain, we have a bias, period. That's powerful. If we have a human brain, we have a bias. We may be unaware of it. We may be denying it. We may be avoiding it, but we have biases. We all have biases, period. And once we can be aware of our biases, once we can be aware of our reactions that happen in our brain, not necessarily what comes out of our mouth, we can start recognizing the role that I'm playing in this space. And then the social awareness, how reading other people's emotions, reading other people's faces, reading other people's body language, just recognizing is empathy, right? So perspective taking is empathy. That's what it is. And I think for DEI to work in an organization, it has to be from that mindset. Like, I got to think something different. I got to learn something different. I got to be curious. I got to be open-minded. And one of the main things that has to happen in workplaces, in classrooms, in schools, is showing up with our authentic selves. I think when we show up with our authentic selves, which are not perfect, but we show up with our authentic selves, our vulnerable selves, our willingness to expose ourselves, it allows other people to share their vulnerability too. It creates a space to have an authentic conversation. And I love this concept about windows and mirrors. So if you think about it, our perspective is like a window. Right now I'm facing a window. And the view that I see from my window is the only view I see. If I want to change my view, I have to change my window. I have to change my lens. I have to change my perspective. The mirror part is that we reflect our biases. We reflect our conditionings subtly. And other people pick up on it. Because of emotional intelligence, because of mirror neurons, it reflects on others. So if we can remember, mirrors and windows. The other thing you were talking about books, I just wanted to share. By the way, I didn't mention, we are doing a session on the 19th of June. Mayor and I are doing a 4-hour training. We're going to share lots of resources there. We're going to share a lot of information there. This is just 1 hour with a little bit tip of the iceberg. But I do want to share some resources with you. I love children's books. This one is An Incredible Me. How about on your team, making a list of all the incredible qualities that each one of us have on the team? This is another one that, this is our common friend, Mayor, and I have Kathleen.
Yes. Friend.
This book is about,
love it.
Yeah, this book is about strengths. I did this with my granddaughter. We listed her strengths, my strengths. We all have strengths. And I think that's what equity is. Coming from a strength-based perspective, not a deficit perspective. Children's books are great. Yum Yum Dim Sim, great conversation starter to have. What do they eat? What does it sound like? What is it called? So lots of resources on Saturday the 19th. Registration, we can share the link. Maybe we can give it to Jen and she can put it in there. But yeah, I'll go forward. I know we have barely any time left.
Yeah, and I'll be doing more songs on Saturday. So
I'll just put in the chat real quick. How are you feeling right now? What is your mode? What emotion are you feeling right now after hearing a little tiny bit of this topic? Let us know how you're thinking. And really, this was really what new traditions can we start? Where can we begin? What can we do intentionally, right? 90% of the brain is getting wired. 90% of the brain is getting wired. The brain that they're going to have as an adult, the seeds are planted now. Let's help them to be confident, be proud of themselves, have strong self-esteem. That's what we want for all our children. That's what we want for all our children. Good. I'm glad that you said reflective. What else emotion are you feeling? And I'm going to let Mary take it from here because we're barely out of time.
Yes. With emotional intelligence, that's a part of when I referred to it when I was doing the puppets. It's important to be able to understand how you feel and what makes you feel that way so that you can relate to other people. And when we're working in early childhood, we want to make sure that we teach children not to just think about themselves like being intrinsic, but being extrinsic. Now, when I sit with children in circle time during Music with Mare class, we will sing our ABCs. Now, these are just little things to think about. I'll have a kindergarten or first grade teacher say to me, why should I sing the ABCs? These kids already know their ABCs. Don't take that for granted. You might have a child in your room that has just moved here from Egypt or Pakistan, and they have a different alphabet. So for them to hear the American alphabet, or reverse that, you're in Egypt and you're doing the alphabet that children are familiar with, and you have a child that's just immigrated there from England and does not understand what is being said. And so I also like to use Mr. Froggy, and we'll be doing him on Saturday. Yeah, Miss Froggy, sorry, not now, you're not going to shine. But we sing to the different children and validate the different ethnicities that are within our circle. But it's also be done on a larger level with the older children or with your staff. You might have a Friday once a month where people get to bring in food from their different cultures and just have a moment to shine. Give everyone a moment to shine, a moment to say, this is what I ate in my house when I was growing up. This is what makes me think of home, and embrace that. I came from Italian relatives that came over from the boat. And yeah, I wanted to go back a minute because I did want to talk about that slide. And I do have grandparents that came over from Ireland, totally different cultures, totally. You know, so respecting that. When I work with the children, I do a song called Come On and Sing, where they have to make up a couplet about their friend. You know, come on and sing, make up a song about a friend. It won't take long, just take words and sing something. Like my friend Prerna was standing in the rain. I like to sing. You could be silly, or you can say something like, my friend Scott sure smiles a lot, and think of something positive. So when I sing a goodbye song to the children, we sing goodbye in many different languages so that everybody gets a chance to hear the way their family might say goodbye. And we don't have time to play that song right now. But this is a really fun song to do with the children, and it invites the children. I'll say, does anybody know another way to say goodbye? And trust me, sometimes I'll get a hand that goes up and I'll say yes, and they'll go, bah, because they just wanted to say something. And I go, well, to you, who else has got something? You know, never make a big deal out of it. Just enjoy the fact that diversity, equity, and inclusion can so easily be taught and must be taught before the end of the 7th year of life. So if you'll join us on Saturday, you can learn some more songs and activities. I know that Genevieve will be sending out the follow-up email, and in it will be a couple of codes so you can download a couple of songs for free. And Prerna, did you want to say something else about this final page? And
yeah, there was a question. And so the training on Saturday is from 8:30 to 12:30 Central Time, and it is $50. And we are going to be sharing tons and tons of resources. You will leave fully equipped with language, with vocabulary, with resources, with activities.
And with a certificate.
With a certificate. And Jen shared a resource link for my website, and that's free. You can download activities, and you can download free songs from there. So yeah, we definitely want to share free stuff, but we also have a lot of content that we're going to be sharing on Saturday. We'd love to see anybody. Scott, I know we're out of time, my friend. We didn't give you a chance to talk. That was not very fair.
He didn't really want to take a time to talk because he just was really into what we were saying. Right, Scott?
That's exactly right, Mayor. That's exactly right. If I'm not talking, that means I'm really interested and I'm enjoying it. No, it's such a delight to be on with both of you. Mayor, it's been an awesome maiden voyage. I've loved it. Let's do
Thank
it again.
You.
Prerna and I are old pros. This is our third time. Few more times and we're gonna have like a regular podcast or something. But to both of you, I think the message here is so beautiful, and I'll close with this. So I grew up in a really interesting family. My parents adopted 18 children.
Oh, children.
My mom and dad, it was such a beautiful thing. So my mom and dad started adopting from Korea in 1975. And I have six siblings that are from Korea. And then as they evolved our family, we started adopting black children. And so this multicultural family just started growing. And then my parents got really, really convicted to open their home to children that had special needs. So as we were going through kind of the parameters of diversity, I was thinking, gosh, this is such a gift. I've had this blessing to have grown up with a family. And I think many of you have read my, when the George Floyd incident happened, I wrote about my brother who I adopted, who is 6'3", black, and looks very different than me. And the experience of raising him, it created this overwhelming empathy. And it's just a gift and a blessing. And I think each of you on this call has that same blessing and that same gift of exposure to really kind of grow your empathy and that emotional intelligence that you all inherently have, because your centers are filled with the gold of diversity, or hopefully they are. And if they aren't, I think you've all seen the beauty and what it brings to an inclusive culture. And so Maryann, Mayor, and Prerna, this session's been such a gift. And I think your session on Saturday is going to be a lot of fun. But more than anything, I think there are just some nuggets and gifts that if you lean into this, and if you really build your culture around kindness, inclusion, and diversity, there's nothing but positive. So thank you both very much.
Thank
we
you.
Love you guys.
Thank you for giving us a platform.
Scott, every time I come and talk to you, I learn something more about you. But now I'm really very impressed with your parents. And if they are living, please say thank you to them from the world, because adopting 18 children is quite a legacy. And I can see why you turned out the way you did. And I can see why we connected. I mean, you genuinely have a heart of gold. And this is because of your bringing up. That's amazing.
It's beautiful.
They were just amazing, beautiful people. Yeah, unfortunately, they're no longer here. But yes, wow. what a beautiful legacy. Absolutely. No, thank you. It was just a pleasure to be in that vector with this crazy, beautiful family for years and years. So on our next call, I'll have to show a family picture because it's really interesting.
Let's see
almost ridiculous. You need a panoramic camera to see everybody.
18 is quite a number. I love it. I'd love to see it.
All right. Well, ladies, we thank you so much. And from all of us at Kangaroo Time, we love you. And good luck on Saturday. If you can be there, please, Genevieve will send out in the follow-up email that everybody receives tomorrow with the link to the video. She will send more information on it. And I'm so glad you're doing it. Guys, this was a great session. Prerna, until next time, Mare, let's do it again. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
This was awesome.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate it.
Loved it.